little pieces now. And the first one is a little piece by, yes, women do compose now. They do everything. And eventually they will produce even a greater than Beethoven, once they're allowed to do everything. And this is a very interesting woman, an American, very simple piece. Certainly it doesn't have the kind of, it's a vague tonality. Music had gone in a different way. Just a little improvisation. It's a minute long by a composer I'm very fond of. Her name is Mrs. H.H.A. Beach. And because she was a woman and her name was H.H.A., everyone made fun of her and called her Ha Ha Beach. She was born in 1867 in a little town in Henniker, New Hampshire, just as the great Scott Joplin was born in Texarkana in 1867 and the great Enrique Granados was born in Spain, to give you an example of where they were in time. Then I want to play a little piece called Postludium by Ernst von Dohnanyi. I love to do things that, you know, I just love to browse through pieces. I get crushes on pieces, 1 minute pieces. I stay with them for a week, a day, maybe just play them once. I have thousands of pieces of music. And I have a crush on it, and little Postludium of Dohnanyi. He was a Hungarian composer. And he was the czar of all piano teaching in Hungary. I mean, if you didn't study with Dohnanyi, you were nobody. He taught Levitsky, he taught Andy Fisher, he taught Vacheri, he taught so many great pianists. And then after the war, he came to the United States. He was, my God, he was still an incredible pianist at 80. And he taught at Florida State University. And then he did something very stupid. He was doing very well, playing all over the United States, teaching, and he married this 20-year-old student, something like that. And he didn't last too long after that. And maybe that's why the piece you will hear, Postludium, is so short. But there is a little passion in it, as you'll hear. Then there's a little piece, you know, Paderewski. He was the greatest name in piano playing. Everyone said that he did everything well except play the piano. It didn't matter. He charmed his audiences and they loved him. And imagine a pianist becoming, you talk about a big achiever. He became the president of Poland right after World War I. He signed for his country the Versailles Treaty. Took him right in and he became premier, and he was an extraordinary diplomat. Lloyd George, Clemenceau, Woodrow Wilson, all thought of him as a stupendous diplomat. But then post-war politics were not so hot, and he was shot at a couple of times. So the great Paderewski said, I better go back and practice. So he left the premiership and started, you know, even doing movies. He did a movie called the Beethoven Sonata. It was a very interesting movie because it's the first time in a film that the true sound of the piano started coming out properly. Before that, they had such trouble. And Paderewski took so much time in making his piano playing really sound like a real piano. That was a breakthrough. I'm going to play a piece, 1 minute long, and it's called A Musical Moment. Now, maybe still hovering in your consciousness, or maybe you played it with the piece that wherever he went, brass bands would play, mayors would make a speech. I mean, this man was the big time. He had his own train that he would come into town with. And he was the man who really brought culture to America. Do you remember this by, and does anyone remember this? Raise your hand. Well, you see, it's still in the cut. He hated this piece, so I won't play it. Then there's an American, McDowell, born in 1862. I think he died in 1908, 1907. He died insane. He had a very, very bad last couple of years. But if he was a German composer, believe me, he'd be played far more. But there's a the snobbery about American music. Well, how do you know? You'd have to be European, Russian, or something, you know. I think this is horrible. In fact, I've started a little thing, and Leonard Bernstein is the chairman, and we're getting every pianist in the United States, from students to famous pianists, to play an American composition in a great festival of American music. And this is the state of Louisiana, isn't it? The greatest of all pianists that was born here was Louis Moreau Gottschalk in New Orleans in 1829. And he's, again, if he were born in France, I mean, he would be, you cannot believe how he'd be honored. But now he's buried in Brooklyn in a cemetery where his tomb is in such disarray, and I want to have a Gottschalk medal made to give it to someone that has helped promote American music, because American piano music, because there's so much great. From Joplin's Rags to Sessions, piano sonatas, I mean, it is an extraordinary literature. And I want the President of the United States, I have big plans, of course. Nothing I do ever works, but that has no meaning. But I want President Bush or Mayor Crotch, Koch, or someone someone to hand out this Gottschalk medal. And if anyone wants to design it for me, send it to me. And I want his grave fixed up. It's a desecration that our great, first great concert pianist is in such a mess. I wanted to play a Gottschalk piece, but I just decided it was too hard for me. I haven't practiced it enough. Then I think I'll do a little Chopin Mazurka, which I have a crush on recently. Not an important one, but Chopin has such nostalgia in his mazurkas. And then Anton Rubinstein. He was one of the great pianists in history. Steinway and Sons brought him here in 1872, and this was an iron man. This was a great educated venture when he came here. America really did not know the great emerging piano literature, and it was Anton Rubinstein. Nobody knows his name even anymore, more or less. He was considered an important composer. You see, fame is fleeting. Don't rely too much on the idea of fame. Not important anyway. Everyone thought he would be one of the immortals. His melody in F maybe is good. Someone could have recognized it. The Romance in E flat, which I'll play. I have a crush on it. It's a pretty piece. Rubinstein came here, though he was an iron man. He played vast programs of serious music from Beethoven sonatas to Chopin etudes and Schumann Carnival, and he made a hit here you cannot imagine. He stormed the United States. He came here in 1872. He gave 215 concerts in the amazing time span of 239 days. Traveling on stagecoach and train. The man was everywhere. And he became almost like a folk hero. There was a poem written called How, and everyone loved him. This was, by the way, this was the beginning of the Russian mystique. And he had a mystique. Liszt called him Van the Second, because he looked, everyone thought he was the illegitimate son of Beethoven. And he looked like this, you know, with his long hair. And he was very moody, and he'd come out on stage, and he would say, the human race does not deserve Opus 111 by Beethoven, but then would proceed to play it. He played all the way to Central City, Colorado. He was everywhere. Back towns, bum, think of it. Well, anyway, he didn't trust the American dollar. He was ahead of his time. And he made Steinway pay him in gold. Except he did not expect all the gold to be so heavy. It was 140 pounds or something like that, which he had to take back to Russia. But he was very, very happy to make this money, because he gave all the money to the conservatory, which is still standing in St. Petersburg, St. Petersburg Conservatory. He says he wanted to be remembered by his conservatory. He said, he wrote an autobiography, but he said, my life is in six works. I live, I love, and I play. And he was everywhere. Tchaikovsky waltz. He wrote so many wonderful little nuggets, little gems. And I'll do that now. This is a wonderful letter. His great friend was Natasha von Meck, and she was the patroness that saved him from having to work. He was a clerk, he was having a hard time, and he came to music late. And she detected a great talent in him, and she was a great friend, but they had a deal. They were never to meet. And they never met each other. She glanced at him or whatever. But they loved each other. And Mozart was Tchaikovsky's love. And in the 19th century, that was actually rare. People were not Mozart crazy like today. I mean, Mozart is everywhere, as he should be. But he was too rococo, too gallant for the 19th century, that saw everything in their own eyes. They weren't as historical as we are. And you know, when you have a friend, and I like this letter because of this, you have a friend who cannot stand when they do not appreciate what you love. If it's a tree, if it's your cat, whatever it be, you want them to love what you want. And this is touching because, as a Russian composer, I mean, he even wrote a suite called Mozartiana. Nobody, I'm telling you, really was into Mozart. Piano concertos, which every month some great pianist gives you another recording. Nobody played any of them, maybe the D minor occasionally. He's writing a long letter, and I'm going to give you an excerpt. But he's in the middle of the letter, he says to von Meck, "Why don't you like Mozart? In this, our opinions differ, dear friend. I not only like Mozart, I worship him. To me, the most beautiful opera ever written is Don Giovanni. You, who have such fine taste in music, must surely love this pure and ideal artist. It is true that Mozart used his gift too generously and often wrote without inspiration because he was compelled to do so by poverty. I don't even believe he ever wrote a thing without inspiration, frankly." That's what I would say to Tchaikovsky if I had a phone conversation with him today and he was saying this to me. No, I would say, "Peter Ilyich, I don't think you're right. Everything, even his least divertimenti, is better than the average composer of the day, Ditters von Dittersdorf or many others. Every single piece has something so interestingly different than the smooth agreeableness of his contemporary." But Peter says to von Meck, "Even Bach and Mozart have left a considerable number of inferior works, not worthy of being mentioned in the same breath as their masterpieces. Occasionally, fate compelled them to lower their arts to the level of a handicraft." But notice the idealism in even this sentence. "But think of Mozart's operas, of two or three of his symphonies, his Requiem, the string quartets dedicated to Haydn, and the G minor string quintet. Do you feel no charm in these works?" And that brings me to Horowitz, who I've had a close friendship with him. And I said to him, because he's doing all this Mozart, and I said, "You know the G minor quintet. He had never heard it. Isn't that fabulous? At 85, never to have heard a masterpiece. What a new experience. You don't have to hear everything by 20, you know." And I played it for him on a recording of the Budapest string quartet, and couldn't believe it. He cried. And I'll get to that, because Tchaikovsky, true Mozart reaches neither the depths nor the heights of Beethoven. His range is not so wide. And since in life, too, he remained a careless child to the end of his days, his music does not have that subjectively tragic quality which is expressed so powerfully in Beethoven. We also hear the little sonata I played is not tragic. There's so much more to Beethoven that was even known then. But this did not prevent him from creating an objectively tragic type, and he goes on to talk about Donna Anna in Don Giovanni. But he says, I love the music of Don Giovanni so much that even as I write you, I could shed tears of agitation and emotion. In his chamber music, Mozart fascinates me by his purity and distinction of style and his exquisite handling of the parts. Here, too, there are things that bring tears to our eyes. I shall mention only the adagio of the G minor string quintet. No one else has ever known how to interpret so beautifully and exquisitely in music the feeling of resignation and inconsolable sorrow. Every time Lau played the adagio for me, I had to hide in the farthest corner of the concert room so that others would not see how much this music affected me. Think of it, there was no recording. Everything was live before him. He had to go to another part of the room. He didn't want anyone to see him cry. We can cry to ourselves if we want. Alone. We can commune with music alone. We don't have to always hear it live. I think we hear too many recordings. But anyway, I go on speaking. I could go on speaking interminably about that radiant genius whom I worship. I mean, this is extravagant. He's trying so hard. Though I am used to considerable variety of taste in music, and though I certainly appreciate freedom from authority, I must confess, my dear, that I should like very much to convert you to Mozart. I know that would be difficult. I have known some other people who also understood and loved music very much, but did not recognize Mozart. I have tried in vain to open up to them the beauty in his music, but never have I wished to convert anyone into a Mozart admirer so much as I now want to convert you. And he goes on still. The idea here is the passion of trying to make your friend understand, and you know the frustration when this happens. Oh, and then I want to play a little Schumann piece, an intermezzo, which has a kind of burning passion which he must have written for Clara Schumann. It was at that time that they could not marry. They were actually stopped from marrying because the dad, who was her piano teacher, said, you cannot marry this weird guy. And Schumann was weird, and his music sounded weird. But Schumann took the man to court and won the case. And they did get married in 1840, he was 30. And out of him, from this expression of love, came 130 or so songs. We now call that his song year. Before that, everything was the piano. His intimate love for the piano, his first 23 opus numbers alone, just for the piano, and how he loved it. So let me play these things. Mrs. Ha Ha Beach.
Thank you.
my program. McDowell loved to write to literature. He was inspired, as many romantics were, and he often put the poem on. And this is from Heine. And I think you'll really get the feeling of this because it's called Scotch Poem. Not vodka, Scotch. And he means Scotland. And you can hear the craggy shore. It's after a Heine poem. Far on Scotland's craggy shore, an old gray castle stands, braving the fierce North Sea. And from a rugged casement there appears a lovely face, a woman's white with woe. She sweeps the harp strings sadly and sings a mournful strain. The wind plays through her tresses, her hair, carries the song away. And you can hear in her little harp-like tune, you can hear the Scotch feeling, the Scotch element, almost as it's a folk song.
Thank you.
Francisco Chopin. Find the Tchaikovsky waltz, Rubinstein romance.